Well, we are on our way to Starbucks. This is the opening video, actually. It's not the opening video. I'm going to talk about two-year-olds. This is the first video of the weekend because I know I can talk about them quicker than 15 minutes, and I have 14 minutes until we get to Starbucks. Just simple math. So I'm going to start with almost there, boss. We talked about a lot of these horses. We're going to talk about turning them out. You know, their year is over. Are you sure that's all of them? Seems like we need more than that. No. Okay. A lot of them, their seasons are over now. They're going to get turned out for a little while and brought back. Some of them are now just coming back, and some of them are qualifying right now. So a good mix heading into the fall 2021 as we drive towards Lexington, Kentucky, and the select sale here in Kentucky 2021. So almost there, boss. Is he
still in the stall?
Yeah, because he aligned his knee. They thought he had a shadow in his knee, but has it been 6 weeks? One more week in the stall, then we'll probably jog him for a week or two, as I said before, just to take some of the pop out of him and then turn him out. Last thing we want to do is stand him in a stall for 6 weeks, turn him out in the field, watch him rip and tear and hurt himself somewhere else. I mean, these are young horses, so that's generally what we do. We did that with Will the Wind Hanover also. So almost there, boss. Apparently, according to my lovely assistant here, Amy McDonald, we have one more week in the stall, and then probably jog for about a week, and then we'll kick him out the field. Amor Diener is out at Schaefer Farms. He's got a lot of our horses out there in Pennsylvania. Good people. They're sending a couple of their babies our way to sell pieces of them to you and to keep pieces of them, I believe. And then see what else we have with Wayne and Jacob Schaefer. Good people. Arches Rainbow's back in now. She's got a weird lump on her stifle. It looks like they might have went a few rounds in the field one day, her and Rosie. But she's sound on it. Looks fine on it.
It's like
it'll come down. It just needs work. So Arches Rainbow, our little girl, is not little anymore. I saw her the other day when I was home. She put on a lot of weight and looks really good. Sean Breezebaugh did a great job with the turnout with those two fillies. And she started up now and starting to jog. Better Be Sawyer is back in now. It's now, what, October? She'll be ready to go December, I think, first part of December. She will be ready to go. Our girl Blue Bayou Dio raced great the other day. Her knees are bothering her a little bit. Rob had her knees done after the race, and they were, in fact, bothering her a little bit. But it's not unrealistic. I'm not surprised by the news. By bothering just means the fluid is a little darker in her knees. And we had it replaced. We had some medication put in there, and she should be really, really good for the final in Freehold. Now, going to have to deal with Tyler Miller and Gertrude, but he draws outside of us. It's not going to be a cakewalk for him, I can tell you that. So, Blue Bayou Dio, excited about the race next Friday in Freehold. I'll tell you what, the race secretary there is so nice. Karen is her name. I sent her an email, and I don't race at Freehold. And I said, good afternoon, Karen. I introduced myself, Anthony McDonald. I'm coming from the Lexington sale to race Blue Bayou Dio in the final. Is there any way you could get the race in before race four? I have a 4:30 flight out of Philadelphia. You know, the race secretary's job is to put the races in the proper place so that they get the most wagered money on them and the most exposure. And she was kind enough. She said, yeah, no problem. Race three or race four, we'll be able to help you out. So thank you very much to Karen for doing that. I'll be able to fly. I'm flying into Newark. And my buddy Vince with the Garmin is going to pick me up at Newark Airport. And then I got to talk to Vince. Actually, Greg Schoner said he was going to come up to Freehold from Philadelphia to watch the race. So I might be able to save Vince a ride. Vince was nice enough. Begrudgingly, I may have backed him into a corner and said, hey, could you drive me down to the Philadelphia airport after the race? And he said, yeah, for you, I'm sure I could. But Greg Schoner's actually coming up from Philadelphia, so I might be able to just jump in with Greg and get a ride back to the airport. It all should work out well. It puts me back in Lexington, Kentucky at 6:18. The airport's about 10 minutes from the sales pavilion. Sale starts at 7.
Do you want me to pick you up, or do you just want to take me?
Would you do that for me?
No.
My wife will pick me up at the airport. So we'll make it to the sale just on time for day 4 in Lexington. Bomb Hugger is out. She came back with a little bump on her left hind leg. Looks like she maybe just hit it playing in the field or something. But I didn't want to turn her out with that bump on her leg. So I asked the girl, just cool it out, put a blister on it, cool it out again, and then she goes to the field. But she was in great spirits and looking very, very good. Mark Beckwith, as always, did a great job with her. Century Invictus, a little upset he didn't make the final. You know, Lissa Colt did a great year. And then, you know, got away in a tough spot and got shuffled back with Jody. Just no racing luck with him. But a great year with Century Invictus, and he'll come out next year swinging, I'm sure. Really turned into a nice colt, a really, really nice colt for us in 2021. Confederate Cruiser will come back in, I guess, end of November, 1st of December. Some of these horses will stay in Ohio. You know, I've committed to keeping 20 or 25 horses in Ohio for the simple reason we need our workers. It's hard to find people work in racing, and we've set up a real good staff in Ohio. They're really loyal, good people, and I want to make sure that we keep them there. So there's no reason why Confederate Cruiser can't jog and train back in Ohio, you know, because he's an Ohio bred. It makes total sense to us. Now, a lot of these Ohio breds that have a number of fair wins, we might not bring them back to Ontario, quite simply because they count them as starts in Ontario. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, Ontario is the only jurisdiction in this universe that counts fair wins as wins. I know that in Pennsylvania and New York they don't. I know for sure they don't. I suspect New Jersey is the same way. The only place that counts those fair wins as win is actual pari-mutuel victories. And they are pari-mutuel victories, so I guess I see where they're coming from, I suppose. But it really makes it hard on the grassroots horses that have raced in these, you know, this diminished competition for the most part. And to count them as wins against, you know, against your record at, say, a track in Mohawk or even Flamborough, Georgia, it's tough, right? You can't bring a horse like Confederate Cruiser, one or two races. It's not fair for him to race in the non-winners of three. I guess from the other side of the fence, if you're a guy and you go to the races and you race in the maiden and there's a horse there with six wins on its card, I could see where you'd be a little upset, but... Nevertheless, it doesn't change what I'm about to say, and that is those particular horses will stay in Ohio, as a Confederate Cruiser still fits a maiden in Ohio, but he does not in Ontario. Duke Dio will. I've been threatening to qualify him for 2 weeks. He will qualify. What exit am I taking here? 41, this one right here. I won't qualify him on Tuesday, but he will qualify on Tuesday. Amy and Greg trained him and 3-point blue chip midweek, and you said he looked good?
Yeah, he looks good.
Duke said he's going to fly under the radar. Both of those Dios are underappreciated horses in our barn for whatever particular reason, but Duke Dio, I personally quietly have semi-high hopes for Duke Dio. I think he's a very nice horse. In fact, we looked at a couple of horses that are first cousins of his that are selling in Lexington. By that, I mean, now what do you want me to do? Turn left, okay. By that, I mean, these are horses that are out of a sister to Duke Dio's mother. That second dam with Donato Hanover in it, a number of horses in that line are in the Harrisburg and Lexington sale catalog. So a good family, very, very royally bred. I think we'll have a lot of fun with Duke Dio. He really changed his attitude and really the way he operated. Midsummer, I could see a change in him. The only reason we turned him out after qualifying, there just wasn't a whole lot for him, right? He's a New Jersey bred in Ohio. At the time, the maidens were going 58, 57 some days at the Meadows and even Northfield Park. I just didn't feel that there was a necessity to race him at that point. So we're getting him ready now. I'd like to see James qualify him in 2-1 or 2-2 on Tuesday. Eyes of 10 will come back in December 1st, as will Garden State Dio. Both of those fillies will come back in December 1st and start their journey. They may or they may not, I'm not sure yet. Why do you hit? Is there one of those horses you want back? We'll see. The boss lady wants Eyes of 10 back in Ontario. Now, technically, she wouldn't have to stay in Ohio because she doesn't have any victories of any kind. But we'll see how the staffing goes in Ohio. How many horses we have in Ohio, how many horses we have in Ontario. That right there will be the biggest deciding factor on who goes where and when. So Grace is racing in the gold on Monday. Little mucus in her throat after training the other day. That's not a hard belief. Oh look, I was looking for BJ's Brew House. What are you beeping at me for? I'm not allowed to go in this lane. Meathead. Shocker. BJ's Brew House right there, right beside the Starbucks.
So you made it to E.
Yeah, I went over my allotted time.
Good job.
I made it to G, by the way. I was talking about Grace.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So Grace will... wait, now is it telling me to turn here? I think I turn here, don't I? 0.1 miles? Either if I don't turn here, I can go up this way. Yeah, it's telling me. It's rerouting me. So Grace had a little bit of mucus in her throat. Not a big deal. We got on top of it right away, and she seems good. Cindy said she went a slow mile with her Saturday, trained awesome, felt good, ate all her feed, no temperatures, no mucus that she could see. So I think it was all maybe just climate, you know, that hot, cold weather. Rained a bit, and it was nice, and it rained. So I think our girl Gracie will be ready to rock on Monday at Mohawk. Look at this. Did they really have this? They got us to go to the Starbucks. It's in. Maybe not. We'll see if you can see it. I hate the Starbucks that are like in the stores. The Kohl's or wherever. Ugh.
It's not even a Starbucks.
Yeah, no, Kohl's.
Oh,
yeah.
Kohl's.
No. I saw one of Kohl's in
usually at Target.
Well, we'll see. Yeah, it says it's further up. Anyway, Grace is ready to rock for Monday. We got Mario on her. James picked off her again. I had a couple of people ask me, why didn't you just put Dougie down? Well, I guess the easiest way is Dougie's not my brother. And Dougie drove her once and jumped on, made some money for himself and did well. But much like Dougie's father, Anthony is going to go with James because, one, he sat behind Grace a lot. He knows her. Would you say it's in the Kroger? The one in the Kroger's okay, though. James knows the filly really, really well, gets along with her really well. So I told James, and I asked him straight up, I said, listen, if you're just going to drive that Mark Etzel filly right through the final, then it's pretty hard for me to put you on the filly. I said, I have to ask. I said, Mark Etzel's filly looked a little tired or sick. This time of year, when they get a little sick, it's harder for them to bounce back. So maybe it was a combination of things, and a Dark Castle or whatever its name is going to run off the screen on Monday. You know, this filly made $300,000 or something this year. She's had a great year. I don't blame James for sticking with her. But if she's tired, are you going to go with a filly like Grace, who's actually fresh, or are you going to stick with her? He said, well, I'll cross that bridge when I come to it. I'm going to go with the better horse in the final, which is fair. That was the right answer to give, both for myself and for Mark Etzel. You know, James is a driver, and his loyalties, I've been there, I know where he's coming from, his loyalties should be to himself and his family. Drive the best horse. I don't get upset about stuff like that. So James is going to drive, I suspect, and I hope that James goes out, and I hope that Mario goes out and wins with her. And I told Mario straight up front too, if Mario wins with her and James wants a driver in the final, James can drive her in the final. That's just racing. And Mario knows the scoop also. But if James drives a Derek Castle and says, I might stick with a Derek Castle, I will likely be Mario if he wins with her. Or whoever else.
I'm up, I guess.
Yeah, you're up.
Yeah.
Good job, bud.
Yeah.
I'd like a venti.
Also,
I'm gonna give you my order right now. Hold on a second. I'm gonna go a little venti, salted caramel cold brew. And
what pastry?
I wasn't going to get a pastry till you just said it, but now I do want a blueberry scone heated up.
What if they don't have that?
They will have that. I will gamble that they will have that.
Okay, I did want to also say that, right? Or Doug had his dad's horse in there. So.
Oh, yeah, Doug probably would have went with his dad's horse, but, you know, either way, it doesn't matter. That's the way it is. So, Grace, Mario's going to get along with her great. I'm excited and happy to put Mario on the filly because he knows her also. He schooled her a couple of times.
Where are we?
No, you don't have to wear a mask.
Well, someone was.
Okay, then wear a mask. I don't care. Wear a mask. It makes you feel better. It's confusing. Yeah, the world's a confusing place. Granite Hill will come back in December 1st. Hill of Magic. I haven't got an update. Now, we must be getting close to... So the vet told us like 3 months before she can probably do anything. I don't know if swimming falls under anything. I suspect 6 to 8 weeks, you're going to see that bone fill in. If she behaves herself, goes in the pool nice and neat and easy, I think she can swim. But I'll talk to the vet about that. I'd like to get her into the pool by November 1st. That would be my goal. Where are we at now? Kathy with an I will be coming back to Ontario very, very soon to start her descent back to the race. Well, not back to the races. She never was there. To the races to begin with. Massive Prophet had his procedure done to take that chip off the front of his pastern. Now, that was an old chip. He trained down with it. He raced with it. The veterinarian surgeon told me that that probably was there from birth. A lot of young horses will injure themselves in that way, and then it'll just heal up in that manner. Now, did it shift? Did it move? Was that causing him just some discomfort? Absolutely could have. No way to know. So the easiest thing to do would just be take it out. It's there. It doesn't need to be there. Take it out. Dr. Cote took it out, and she did a great job, I'm sure. All green check marks across the board for Massive Prophet. Matt's MVP, December 1st. Of Tom, December 1st. They'll both come back in. 1-2 skip a few. Man, that sucks, eh? Getting beat in neck. A win gets you in the final. Now we're like the Toronto Blue Jays. We already did do our work. But we have to watch the scoreboard and see what everybody else does. I think there has to be a horse finish out of the top two at Dayton today at the fair in Dayton. If that happens, that puts us at a first also eligible standpoint. Then we have to reevaluate the nine ahead of us and say, okay, is there a chance any one of these nine horses are not going to enter? Hope that they don't. We'll see, but as of right now, 1-2 skip a few is not in the fair final. But you could still find her. She could still find her way there. Really excited for 1-2 skip a few in the fair for the fair final next week. Man, she raced great yesterday. She's such a little trooper. Peanut Butter and Jelly will come back in December 1st. Now, the next is a little trickier. Peanut Butter and Jelly come back in December 1st, as many of our horses do. Now, Prairie Fire. There's a horse that missed all the summer, missed his entire season. He's good right now. He's out in the field. I think I'm only going to give him a month in the field, and then I'm going to bring him back in, start jogging him. Let's call it an even November 1st, right? An even November 1st for Prairie Fire to come back in. That will get him 6 weeks in the field. And then, because every horse should be given the opportunity to mature and grow as a two-year-old. So yeah, we'll give him the 6 weeks. He'll come back in November the 1st. Prairie Fire will come back. Procrastinator, December 1st. He'll come back in. What about our girl Purple Aura setting the track record at Dayton last night? It was so funny. A gentleman, he was all dressed up, and he had his girlfriend with him, and he comes up to me and he goes, "You're my favorite driver." I said, "You don't know too many drivers, do you, sir?" And he laughed and he goes, "I like betting the stable horses. I like watching the stable horses." He said, "What about the filly in the first?" He said, "Geez, she's had a great year." I said, "Yeah, she has." He said, "Do you think she can win?" I said, "Wow. I think she has a shot. Yeah, she's a pretty nice filly." He goes, "Do you think she can make front?" I say, "Sir, clearly you haven't watched enough races. She will be on the front. They're close to it, I can assure you of that. It's the end of the year. We're racing for $75,000 with one of the better fillies in the division. She'll be near the front end, don't worry." She raced great. I got a tiny little breather. You know, that filly is... And you know what? This is indicative of Ohio itself. When you look at Bomb Hugger, Renegade Gypsy, all those horses that race tough all year, all our stake horses, they get a little tired this time of year. Yet our Ohio breds are just switching gears, it seems like. That's what racing in those fairs, that fair circuit, allows you to do. A win for a horse is like a win for me, right? If you have me racing horses all year and I'm just bouncing around, winning the odd one and getting chewed up and ground into the ground, come the end of the year, I'm exhausted. You know, I just need a break. But you put me in a position to win some races here and there, and you sharpen right up. There's a bounce in your step. You feel sharp. You feel confident. That's what horses are like, too. And you can be certain that that played a major role in Purple Aura being the filly she is, and certainly the filly she was last night was the fair circuit throughout the summer. So keep that in mind next year, the route we took for Purple Aura to be where she is. I think that filly went over 80,000 last night for the year. Just an incredible season for her. Very, very happy for the people that own her. And here's a little something. We got her going into the Buckeye final also for 60. By the way, Ed, you told me it was 75. That's a big negative. It's 60. But here's the filly going into the final. Just won the consolation for the Sire Stakes heading into the Buckeye Final. She's going to be a force to be reckoned with, for sure. Now, as I said, I can't drive Purple Aura in the final. I can't. I have to go with 1-2 Skip a Few because I own a decent chunk of 1-2 Skip a Few. And sadly, I'm not one of your partners on Purple Aura. So, the great year for Purple Aura won't matter. I mean, look at the way she, anybody can drive Purple Aura right now. She's a sweetheart. So, Purple Aura will be heading into the Buckeye Final with our girl Skip-A-Doo on the 16th of October. Where are we at now? 1-2 Skip a Few, Peanut Butter Jelly, Prairie Fire, Procrastinator, Purple Aura, Renegade Gypsy. He's tired. Renegade Gypsy's tired, I believe, from what I saw the other night. Probably the same thing you saw. Probably going to have to hit a helmet, stay there, and try and grab some money for the final. He's had a long season. He'll be a good three-year-old for us. He's built nice. He looks good. Just want to turn him out immediately after his race next week and get him as much time in the field as we can. He'll come back in first part of December. Resolute Bay is out in the field now. Jeez, that sucked. They're getting run into in the final. But it happens. It's racing, and he'll come back. He looks much bigger now. You know, just looks good now. You can really see the way he's matured over the last 3-4 months. I think Resolute Bay will be a pretty nice three-year-old for us. Rose Above It looks much bigger, too. He come back in. Jason made a point. He said, come here, look at this horse. He said, look how much bigger he is. He said, when he went out, he was just a little midget. He said, he's big and looks really, really good. And, you know, that's indicative of the places you send them. You know, Schaefer Farms has done a fantastic job with their horses. They all come in fat, big, strong. They got tons of hills on that property. It's just, it's a really good place to turn your horses out. And very, very happy and very fortunate and lucky to have come across Wayne and Jacob Schaefer. Very, very nice people. Rosie's Masterpiece looks good. She came in good also. I might take Rosie up to the top barn for a little bit with me when I get home full time. Want to work on her and see where she's at. You know, this is a filly that I have pretty high hopes for. She was just immature when we raced her and needed some time off. We gave it to her. I'm interested to see what's going to happen with her in 2022. Slim Jimmy, same thing. The veterinarian looked at him. So he had a small OCD at the start of the summer, and they said it may have been absorbed. I think it kind of gets ground into dust maybe in their joint. That doesn't mean that it isn't and didn't bother him. Thank you. But it's not there now. All that's there is a little notch. It'll fill in. So there's nothing needed to be done with Slim Jimmy. He has gone to the field now. Went to Schaefer Farms the other day. Stonebridge Dolce. Who would have thought this filly that was so horrible her entire life, from breaking her to now, would look the way she did the other day? She looked awesome. Well, that's unacceptable. Okay. They don't warm stuff up. They don't have a microwave in 2021? What kind of a Bush League operation
is that? It's in a grocery store. What do you expect?
I have never been to any Starbucks in any capacity where they do not have the ability to heat up food. I think that lady pulled one over.
No, she didn't. She said, do you still want it?
And I said, nah, I think she's fibbing. And I think there's a 10% chance you forgot to tell her to warm it up.
No, I didn't. Because
in my mind, I'm thinking to myself.
No, I said, can I please have...
In my mind, I'm thinking to myself, Amy forgot.
No, I didn't.
I know you said you didn't, but who's not going to...
You can go ask.
You're going to double down.
Just go.
There's a 3% chance of me that wants to go in and say, hey, I'm going to call you on it. But I'm not going to call shenanigans. I'm going to believe you. You're my wife. We're married. I love you to death. So I'm going to believe you that they can't warm it up. Where were we? You interrupted me. Stonebridge Dolce was fantastic the other day. For her, if you would have said to me in March, hey, come September, Stonebridge Dolce is going to be third in her first lifetime start at the Meadows in 59. Come half in 59.
March.
Yeah, I don't believe so.
Pulling shenanigans on her in December.
Yeah, she didn't look gifted. To the point where I wouldn't even sell anybody any shares of her. But Stonebridge Farms and I own that filly. Very happy with what I saw from her. You can see, one, there is a horse hiding in there. There's a decent horse hiding in there. It's just a matter, it'll be maturity. As I said to Dr. Stiller, I'd like to race her 2 or 3 times and turn her out. I didn't want him to race her when I was gone away. I want to be there. So, oh, by the way, I got to go back to the Meadows on Wednesday. I forgot to tell you that. After. Not during the sale. Next week when I go home.
Which home?
Yeah, which home? I joke with Amy now. I said, how's your house? When I go home to Ontario, I got to go back Wednesday to Northfield and Meadows.
To drive Dolce. Yeah.
Okay. Why are you making a face like that? Dolce is a sweetheart. So Stonebridge Dolce got three starts ahead of her.
Stand on the list of importance.
Well, you're just behind Dolce. Stonebridge Dolce, very happy with her and can't wait to actually race her next week. Stonebridge Akati is back in now and going. He looks really, really good. You know, it's always worth mentioning that how good a year Mario had, right? Mario Bergeron's barn was very good, very happy. You know, I feel a little silly saying I'm proud. I mean, Mario's he's 400 years old, but no, he's a little older. But, you know, you never die in this game, and Mario takes his job very seriously, takes his barn very seriously, and I'm very, very happy with the results of 2021, not just as a guy from the stable, but for him, too, as an older horseman, knowing that, you know, the days of being Mario that wins 8,000 races are gone. You know, they're in the history books. There's nothing wrong with that. But turning the page and writing a new chapter for himself is important. It's important for people in this industry like Mario to be able to do that. And I'm so happy that we were able to be a part of that. Sweet on Pete. An unfortunate break in the final and then she ran into Mother Nature in the breeders. But she had a great season. She's out now in the field playing and having fun. 3-point blue chip. Another horse. Come March, we were like, oh, I don't know what it'd be like. We took our time. We did it right. And it has paid off. Tom Grossman messaged me immediately after the race the other day. Not just 3 points race to tell me the horse looked fantastic, because he did. And Bob Young stopped me. I saw Bob Young was in Freehold. On Friday Racing Horse, he said, that colt you got is a really nice colt. 3-point he was talking about. So Tom messaged me right after the race in Kentucky. The horse that 3-point run down and beat the other night at Mohawk was just beaten in 53 in Kentucky the other day. Food for thought. So very pleased with 3-point blue chip. You are going to New Jersey with Jason in 3-point blue chip. I'm going to play Mr. Mom and go home to Ontario and take care of the kids. So the kids are not allowed to go to Ohio with me if I decide
No.
They're not allowed to go to Ohio. So Amy's going to come up from New Jersey.
Oh, my God. Don't even
start. A postcard from Ohio. See ya. We're in Ohio. So 3-point blue chip. Amy and Jason are going to take 3-point blue chip to New Jersey. I ran into Andrew Harris. He said he had stalls. I've talked to a few people. They all said they have stalls. So wherever you guys decide you want to go, there won't be a problem going anywhere. Gateway or any of those places or in New Jersey. I wonder if Jason wants to take any other horses with him.
Do we need the truck and trailer?
Yeah, you guys can take it if you want. That'll be up to him and you. I don't care. Taiwan On. Huge season from this filly, too, and she's so big and lanky. I'm so excited to see what type of filly Wayne Schaefer sends me back, because she is going to be massive next year. Tioga Sunshine, another filly, needs a good 2.5 months off. She raced great this year. I know it's hard to look at a horse trots in 2-2 and say she races great, but she did. She took the tools we gave her and made the most of them and did what she could. And I think the speed will come with that filly. The pedigree, the breeding will bubble up, and she's going to be a nice 3-year-old for us. Twinbee Habanero will come back in, obviously. When are we going to take him back? Take him back. I might send him to Ohio and let them jog him for a month and then bring him home. Very happy with what I've seen from him in the field also. Very well-bred horse. His sister had a great year. Super excited to race Twinbee Habanero in 2022. Twinkle in her eye again. Didn't have the year that Century Invictus did. We were hoping they'd both like turn on and come forward. But she did place 57 once, I think, or 56. She did have a decent year, and I suspect, again, here's a horse we're hoping her breeding will bubble up in 2022. Unbeatable Kemp trotted in 54, took a mark of 56.5, has had a great year. You know, here's the sad thing. Had a great year, but put together $14,000. How sad is that? It's just the way the year worked out, and I think next year we're going to try and map out a little stiffer schedule for him, but he has proven he's going to be a nice 3-year-old. Here's a horse that I think trotted 57, 56, 55, 54, always raced good. That's not true. If you didn't drive him properly, he would...
sell someone on
the... No. From where?
No, that's not us.
That's weird. Did I sell a wheelbarrow? Why would I sell a wheelbarrow? Who does that? So, Unbeatable Kemp. Great season. Gonna be a nice filly. I really think, gonna be a nice colt. I really think he's gonna turn into a decent horse in 2022. He's proven he can go. And yes, he threw a couple of clunkers in. You can't put him on the front. You can't be first over. I'm gonna tell you something. Can't drive a 3-point blue chip like that either. So, and as I said that, I did put Unbeatable Kemp on the front the night he won. But I think he understood, you know, this was his home track, so to speak, Northfield Park. He knew that I was sitting behind him. He felt a little more comfortable. And especially when they couldn't catch up to him, horses like him like to be bullies when they can. And he just felt great that week and then came out with another great race in Kentucky after that. But he did bleed a little bit and we opted to shut the rest of the season down. Now, we've talked about this. It's worth noting this again. We've talked about this a couple of times where horses have bled a little bit. We check them quite often. And I think it's indicative of that... of the way we do that. If the horses, like when you have a horse like Unbeatable Kemp trotting 54 and a piece last quarter and 28-3, you wouldn't think to scope him, but we did because I wanted to make sure that he was all right. I didn't want to put him in a place where he was uncomfortable or hurt him. And we discovered that he did bleed that day, in fact, and that was his last race of the season. That doesn't mean that he'll bleed next year. It doesn't mean that he's going to need Lasix. If he does, we'll go that route. We have that option. But we took the route of simply turning him out, which I think 100% was the right way to go, and I think he'll be a very good three-year-old for us. Voyage of Ice and Fire, I can only hope. Very disappointed with what I saw from this horse this year. This is a horse we paid into the next generation. This is a horse we all liked, we all touted, especially me, and he turned out to be a massive flop. So I'm hoping that whatever switch he turned off in July, he finds a way to turn it back on, or he won't be with us long in 2022. Will to Win Hanover was everybody's number one pick this year. Got injured, put a little line in her coffin bone. It healed up perfectly. She jogged back perfectly. She's out in the field playing. I suspect a great 2022 coming for this filly. Keep an eye on her. The same horse that we turned out, or the same horse that we were training down that everyone loved, that grittiness, it's still there, and I think she's going to have a great 2022. World for Two, another horse. I'm super excited to race this horse at three. He's going to come to Pennsylvania early on in his three-year-old season, I believe, and start over here. Tim had asked about him the other day. I said December 1st he'll come back in. He'll be ready to roll. End of February, he may even make his first start of 2022 at the Meadows. We'll see, but World for Two, a horse I'm super excited to race next year also. So my 15-minute video turned into a 32-minute video. We are on our way right now from the Kroger, where they don't warm up blueberry scones, to the Lexington Sales Pavilion at Fazzik Tipton to look at some babies for you. Take care.